Hi, how are you today? Welcome to our new life. This is a program where we're chatting on spiritual growth and see how we can, within these 40 days, create a new life. Welcome on board. I'm really excited for us to start today's broadcast. So we're live on Instagram, we're live on Facebook, and we're recording this for YouTube. So if you've been following us, today is day 7. And we've decided we're going to go this long haul for this 40-day program. Now, sincere apologies. Yesterday, we came in really, really late. Again, like we said, we're juggling the time to see what is the best time to come with this broadcast. Apart from the best time, we also have issues with various activities that we're involved with. We're attending to clients, we're attending to students, and then we're taking on as many varied things as possible that usually comes to us. So that's why we are juggling the time to see which one is best. But today we're actually coming to you in the afternoon UK time, which is nearly 2:30 in the afternoon. So welcome on board, and like we normally do, feel free to give us a shout out if you're logged in. If you have any questions based on what we've done so far, please feel free again to send us your questions. If you're joining us for the first time, we've been recording it for YouTube. So on YouTube up until yesterday's activity. So today is the only new thing that's happened. So what you can do, if you're joining us for the first time and you know you want to know what we've been up to, go onto YouTube and check. We call it the new life, the 40-day plan or 40-day program. And then there's day 1 and there's day 2. You know, it carries on like that till today being day 7. So let's get on with this. What's so exciting about this program? Like I said yesterday, I have found out that it is absolutely brilliant. Oh, I just remembered what I was apologizing about was yesterday's broadcast wasn't really clear at all. Because when I went back to look at it, it was really like jumpy and it was extremely dark. So everyone who joined us then, sincere apologies if you were struggling with yours as well. It's all about the network. Because we are working with so many equipment, so we don't really know what's happening. We're hoping that as we progress, it's going to get better and better and it's going to stabilize. So apologies for that. Let's see how today turns out. Anyway, so day 7, what are we looking at? Before I delve into day 7, I have been reflecting on all the things we've done so far, all the things we've talked about. And what happens is I get occasional, you know, spiritual messages, or I get an idea hits me and it tries to clarify something I read which I didn't understand. And so the one that came to me was life is a trust, and we read this in chapter 5. So God has entrusted us with so many skills. So it was kind of trying to explain to me in there. It said life is a test and then life is a trust. And so the trust part, I was still struggling with that. And so it's a trust because God trusts us with so many things by creating us and sending us here. And so he's trusted us with so many skills, so many talents, so many knowledge, so many experiences. And it's not for us to keep these things to ourselves, but it's for us to use it just for our family alone. It's for us to share it with the rest of the world. I see us as God's partners here on earth. That's the way I see it. Because God sending us here is to follow his message. And his message is coming through us. Because it's gone past the stage when, you know, during the time of Adam and Eve, when God was actually coming down on earth and walking with them. That's what the Bible tells us. So he got to a stage where he said, okay, I'm not going to come down anymore physically, but I'm going to be sending you to come and do the work for us and for me. And that's what it is. So all of us here, to me, we're partners in God's work. And so whenever we're sent here, our job is to come and do God's will. Do God's will, and that is why our time is limited. So we were reading that in chapter 6, where he really broke it down to say we only have, you know, up to 100 years. Maybe it was in chapter 6, but there's one of the chapters that really broke it down. 100 years. And Bible says it's 70 or 80 when our body can carry us. So he's here to further God's kingdom. And most of us think that the purpose of life is to make money. This is where the message was becoming really clear to me. Because what pushed me to take this on? I was struggling with financial issues, and I'm having emotional issues, and I'm having marital issues, and something said, you know what, this is not who you are. You need to find out what is causing all this. And that's when I decided, let me take this book. Oh, by the way, let me show you the book again. It's called The Purpose-Driven Life, just in case you're joining us for the first time. And I remember I had this book and I read something in there and it touched me and it made me really go into action and get on with life. So, life is not the reason we are, money is not the reason we are here on earth. So we've all got it all mixed up. If there is nothing else I get from this book, this is the most important message I'm getting. The fact that, you know, our life is a trust from God. And he wants me to use it for his glory. So he wants us to use all these things, these talents, these skills, this information, these experiences. And I'll dive a bit more into experiences. Because what happens, most times we have bad experiences. Generally, we just get so angry with God. And he said, but why are you making me go through this? If you loved me, you wouldn't let me go through this experience. But that's where we get it all wrong, because the experience makes us stronger. And you know, there's that saying that anything that doesn't kill us makes us stronger. So if you have a negative experience, you're not meant to crumble under it. You're not meant to give up and say, you know what, this is the worst experience ever. Because I was experiencing that too. I was experiencing difficult times and I thought, oh my goodness. But the strength that came to me was like, you're not just that person. You're not just that experience. You're meant to share this knowledge with the rest of the world, because there's so many other people who are going through similar things. And that was when I, obviously with the knowledge I have using YouTube and internet, I hopped on to my channel and I started sharing my experience with women, and I'm getting so many feedback, people thanking me for giving them a message that's lifting them up. So that's what we need to know. So he wants us to use this message, what he's given us, for his glory, by sharing this message with others. So I am sharing my message with you, and then or my experience with you. I'm also sharing my training with women to give them skills, which is where our home training comes in, which we show as many people as possible. Then we get people coming here to train, which I mentioned that we're also very busy with students. So we have the home training part for people who are all over the world and cannot really go through the trouble of traveling down to us here. Again, my experience was a good example of this, because when I lost my corporate job and I had kids to feed and I had to struggle, I had to find a way, and I hopped into hair. So that's what energized me. That's what encouraged me to share my knowledge with the rest of women out there who are equally in the kind of experience that I had. So I always use my experience to further God's work through me. So designing women's beauty, you know, women's hair with creative craft, where people come here and I get their hair done. But when I do that, what am I sharing? I'm sharing that feeling of feeling good. Because when a woman looks at herself in the mirror and she feels good, or she looks good, she feels good. And when she feels good, she goes out there to do great things. So for people who are using hair as the skill that God has given them to be able to share with other people, you don't need to sit back and feel back and still remind yourself that, but there's still something else I should be doing. You're doing the right thing. If all you want to do is work with hair, then that's a skill, that's a talent that God has given you to use in enhancing the beauty of other women who can then also go out there and do their thing. Healthy food. Again, this is another area where I'm excited. I like to talk to people about eating healthy, because you remember we talked about how far our body can carry us. So if you find you're eating healthy, your body stays strong. But if you start eating unhealthy foods, you know, like I call it garbage in, garbage out, you find that the body starts to crumble. So whatever it is, these things that's in you, that's exciting you, that you want to share with other people, that you want to do, you know, like the fashion as well. I have the, you know, my absolute love for the African fashion. I love the colorfulness of it. I love the creativity that comes with it. That's what I'm sharing as well. And I call it the African queen. So whatever it is you find you're great at, anything that you enjoy doing, those are gifts. Those are talents. Those are the things God has entrusted you with. And that's why you need to use it to his glory. So when we help do people's hair, We make them feel good. That's what I just explained. And we also have this experience with musicians as well. So when they sing like Beyonce and, you know, all the rest of them, and they sing and we go out, we buy the ticket for the concert and we attend it. Mary J. Blige, I went with some of my friends the other, you know, last year when she came. And we were in that huge hall and everyone was singing and jumping and being excited. What has she shared with us? She shared this skill and knowledge that she has of singing. And then what were we feeling? We were feeling great. So by you feeling great, she has achieved a purpose. She has shared a piece of her gift with us. And that's what I want all of us to take on from this big, you know, this big message that I feel, if nothing else, this is a big message for all of us to take on. You know, other things like photography and videography, you know, when you take a photograph and a person looks at this photograph and thinks that, oh my goodness, I look amazing in this photograph, that's a feeling. And once that person feels that, you have shared a bit of you with that person. And you sharing a bit of you is sharing God with that person. And so we don't get more money from sharing our gifts, or we get money. So like musicians, the more they sell the tickets, that's when they get money. And it made me think, because there was a time I used to wonder, how come there's no school that teach money? No, there's no school out there that teach how to make money, when we all know that money is a major need of everyone. And this finally opened my eyes to it. Because simply chasing money for the sake of money does not give you anything. You're never going to just, there's nowhere that you go chasing and say, oh, this is where money is. There's no such place. Because the message that then finally came to me was, if we are really that keen on knowing how to make money, hello, all you have to do is buy the money making machine. So buy the money making machine and print your own money. But of course, when you do that, then it becomes illegal money printing. Shop and they take all kinds of machine and they scan it and they want to be sure and they look it, and because they want to be sure that it's not fake money. So if you want to know just how to make money, buy a money making machine, sit down, print fake money and throw it out into the system. But you can't be doing that because you'll be caught. And so there's also that word that the blessings of God makes you rich without adding sorrow. So do you get the message? So if God has given you a talent, a skill, something to use, when you use it, just like musicians do, just like writers do, you will get money back. Just like I do when I give my hair service, people pay me. When I give my training, people pay me. So the more of your knowledge or your skill or your gift that God gave you to give out, the more you get back. And that's how they say the universe pays you back. That's how they say, you know, anything you sow, you reap. So by giving a skill out, you reap a result. And that's the biggest message that's coming out of this. So these are just the things that I was just looking back and wondering, what is the message here? What is the message here? And so this explains it all. You have to give something to get something. What you sow, you shall reap. And so this is a big message to all our young ones who just think, I'm just going to go out there and just make money. And I always ask people, by doing what? So that's what you need to know. By doing what? What will I do that people will pay me back for? Because it's that thing that you do that becomes the gift that God gave you. And so, he says, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven, and everything else will be added unto you. And this is Matthew 6, verse 33 to 34. So by going to God first to find out what his mission is for you, you will know. And once you know, then you'll be walking towards achieving things, because then God has given you what to use to get something back. He said, ask God first to give you your purpose, and you will then find out the gifts he has entrusted you with. It is from these gifts you will get paid or not. Because in the last chapter, he also explains that it's not, by believing in God doesn't necessarily mean you're going to be rich. No, that's not what it means, because he gave an example where John the Baptist was a faithful servant of God and he was murdered. He was beheaded. Jesus was God's son and he was crucified. Paul was imprisoned. So it does not necessarily mean that every message, every gift God gives you is the one that's going to make you this rich person. No, Because remember, all this wealth, we read in Ecclesiastes, is vanity upon vanity. It comes to nothing. You're not taking it to heaven. But the main thing is, while we are here on earth doing His will, He's given us things to use that will compensate us. So, first of all, let's find out what His purpose is for us. And that's what this book is all about. So, we have to remember at all times, He has the whole world in His hands. Everything we are is in God's hands. So that was my reflection. And I really would like to hear from you. If you've been following me on this journey, and some of you wrote back to say, yes, you do have the book. I really want you to take your time to read through it and tell me what you are experiencing, or at least following us with all the messages we are sending out. See what's happening and tell us what you are experiencing as well. But today we're going to delve into chapter 7. Chapter 7, it says the reason for everything. What is the reason that we're here? Everything comes from God alone. We've just explained that He owns everything. Everything lives by His purpose, by His power, and everything is for His glory. And He wrote that in Romans chapter 11, verse 36. He said the Lord has made everything for His own purpose. And that's in Proverbs 16, verse 4. So we're going deeper into the chapter. And I say, it's all for Him. The ultimate goal of the universe is to show the glory of God. It is the reason for everything that exists, including me and you. Without God's glory, there'll be nothing. Glory, God not giving us glory, this world would not exist. What is the glory of God? And it is who God is. God's glory is the expression of His goodness and all His order, intrinsic, eternal qualities. That's what God's glory is. Where is the glory of God? It says, look around you and inside you, because everything you are is God's glory. Everything around you is God's glory. Everything God created reflects His glory in so many ways. Everything He created. So you look at the flowers in the garden, you look at the birds in the air, you look at the animals in the forest, you look at the trees in the forest, you look at the sea, the serenity of it, you look at the mountains, you look at the valleys, everything God created. Creation reveals our Creator's glory. I mean, we went to Switzerland, I think 2 years ago or a year ago, and we went by road. And I tell you, I have not seen anything like this in my whole life. To me, is one of the biggest things anybody should see in their lifetime. The mountains. Some of the, you know, the minute we drive out of a tunnel and you see this vast array of mountains and there was snow on them. So I just, at that stage, I just said, oh my goodness, thank you so much, God, for your creation. No human being could have created that. And you've seen people go on Mount Everest, and you hear sometimes they can't come down. I watched a movie and I saw these two men, how they coped, eventually finally got there and came back. That's God's glory. Who can you possibly say created those things? So, in nature we learn God is powerful. He enjoys variety. That comes when you're not seeing us, you see various races, which is why sometimes it makes you wonder when people want to be racist to each other. Oh, because you're black and you are white, or you're Chinese or you're Asian and Chinese, or Mexican, or, you know, you hear people being all funny to each other just because they are not the same color. But God loves variety. And I remember responding to some comment who wants about racism, and I said, but people eat salad. When you say you're eating salad, have you carried just one leaf and put it in the plate to eat? It's usually various colors, and that's what a salad is. So if you can afford to eat salad with various colors, why can you not live together as normal human beings in various colors? And then when you go into the garden too and you see the flowers, if God wanted just one color, we would not have any other color flower. It would be just the one color. But no. God created everything in various colors. So God likes variety. He likes different sizes. And that's why you see some of us tall and short and big and small and skinny and, you know, every size God loves it. He loves various shapes. He loves beauty. Again, beauty comes in so many colors and so many shades. And I remember one time I think this was like 2 years ago or so, it was in the mail newspaper online. And they were going, oh, black women are the ugliest in the races. And I thought, really? Because beauty is in the eyes of every beholder. So how do you know what I'm looking for beauty? Nobody does. And for God to have created us in various designs, that means He loves us in whatever shape that we are. He loves beauty. So He creates us in various places, you know, various designs. Again, all shapes. God is organized, because then you see how the seasons come and go. And again, we read that in Ecclesiastes where it says there's time for everything. Which is why sometimes I wonder, like here in the UK or, you know, in the Western world, you see every fruit in season 24/7, or, you know, 12 months of the year, every fruit is in season. But in Africa, Nigeria, where I come from, there's a time for a particular fruit. You just know this fruit is in season now. And then another time, that fruit is in season now. That vegetable is in season now. So it follows different, you know, times of the year, different things come. That's how God works. He's extremely organized. He is wise and creative. Bible says the heavens declares the glory of God. God has revealed His glory to people in history. In the Garden of Eden, He revealed His glory. To Moses, in the burning bush, He revealed His glory. In the tabernacles, in the temples, etc. Through Jesus Christ, He revealed His glory. In the churches, He reveals His glory. So, God is all glory. God is a brilliant light. God's glory is best seen in Jesus Christ, who happens to be the light of the world. God's inherent glory is what He possesses, because He is God. It is His nature. We cannot add anything to His nature or glory. We are commanded to recognize His glory and live for His glory, declare His glory, praise His glory, reflect His glory, and live for His glory. And that's what this chapter is really bringing to us. And the question was, why? He says, because God deserves it. We owe Him every honor we can possibly give. Since God made all things, He deserves all the glory. In the universe, only two of God's creation failed to bring Him glory. And that's quite interesting. And He explains, He says, the fallen angels, which is the demon. We hear of demon in all forms, and because they're spirits, and what they tend to do is they take over people's mindset and the, you know, the way you think, the way you start thinking negatively, and then you know that that's the demon's work at work. And then the second of God's creation that fails to recognize or give Him glory is us humans. And it comes from this freedom of choice. So the minute we have a choice to think and feel and act, and then we start choosing negative. Most of the time. Most of us don't want to hear when you talk to God and they go like, what's that? And then you hear them say, but I wasn't created by anything. Okay, so you own yourself. And then he's always usually at the, you know, deathbed. Then people remember, oh my goodness, God, please forgive me. I'm not God, I'm not here to judge anyone. But he's just saying that the two major creation that God has that struggle to praise God or glorify God is the fallen angels and the humans. He said all sin at its root is failing to give God glory. And that's where all the sin started from. He said, loving anything else more than God is where the problem starts. Refusing to give God glory is prideful rebellion. And that's when it starts to go wrong. We start to say, but we, you know, who is God? And why should I praise him? And why should I glorify him? And why should I look up to him? That's rebellion. You're rebelling. He said, none of us have given God the full glory he deserves from our lives. This is the worst sin and the biggest mistake we can make. That's what he said. On the other hand, living for God's glory is the greatest achievement we can accomplish in our lives. And the Bible says, they are my own people, and I created them to bring me glory. That's what God said to us. So that should be our supreme goal. That should be the biggest thing we live for, to give God the glory. So he's now asking us, how can we give God glory? How can I bring God glory? And Jesus told the Father, I brought glory to you here on earth by doing everything you told me to do. So Jesus honored God by fulfilling his purpose on earth, which was coming here and then being sacrificed for us, for our sins. When anything in creation fulfills its purpose, it brings glory to God. So do you see where we're going? We're gradually trying to find out our purpose. Because as we are beginning to find our purpose, we will realize that by doing that which God created us for, we are fulfilling God's glory, or we are giving him glory. He says the birds bring glory to God by flying, by chirping, by nesting, and doing whatever they're supposed to do. The birds do that. The animals do that. The flowers do that. And he quoted somebody, Saint Irenaeus said, the glory of God is a human being fully alive. So would you say you're fully alive? Would I say I'm fully alive? I don't know. We read a few passages or chapters where he explained to us that we're not meant to be complete here. And that's why sometimes, no matter what we achieve, we still want more. But that's where we're going. We're trying to find out what the purpose is. Why are we here? There are many ways we bring glory to God. And he summarizes it in five. But he says, further in the book, he's going to break them down into more details. But he just gives us tips of what they are. Number one, he says, we bring glory by worshiping God. So when you worship God, you're giving him glory. And he quotes again C.S. Lewis, in commanding us to glorify him, God is inviting us to enjoy him. So when you glorify God, you're enjoying God. God wants our worship to be motivated by love. So we should worship God through love, through thanksgiving, and through delight. So you're excited, you're happy for his creation, you're happy for being here. He says, don't go worshiping God as duty. Lots of people do that. We only remember to worship God. Oh yeah, have you been to church today? No, I haven't, because, oh, I'm going. And you just go out of duty. You never really sat back to say, I am going to church because, yes, I want to be in a quiet corner with my God. Or I want to sit on my own and just give him glory by, you know, by me being on my own. You just do it because your parents say you should, or because your husband says you should, or because your wife says you should do that. And so you just do it out of duty. He said, no, you should do it out of love and thanksgiving and delight. And worship is a lifestyle of enjoying God, loving him, and giving ourselves to be used for his purpose. So when you worship him, you are telling him, Father, I'm here, use me. Number two, he says, we bring God glory by loving other believers. So basically loving other people that God created. He said, our love for each other proves that we have gone from death to life. And Paul said in the Bible, accept each other just as Christ has accepted you, then God will be glorified. So if we learn to accept each other, we talked about racism as well, we talked about people, you know, in various shapes and colors, and then we're being all funny around other people who don't look like us. He said, when we accept each other, we're loving each other the same way Christ accepted us and died for us. He said, number three, we bring God glory by becoming like Christ. Once we are born into God's family, He wants us to grow the spiritual maturity. He wants us to grow to spiritual maturity. And spiritual maturity is becoming like Christ in the way He feels, the way He acts, and the way He thinks. And Bible says that the Spirit of the Lord works within us. We become more and more like Him and reflect His glory even more. As the Spirit of God works in us, we become more and more like Christ. Number four, we bring God glory by serving others with our gifts. So that was the biggest one. You remember when I just reflected on the last chapter? He brought it here. It's one way we, you know, we reflect God's glory. We serve others with our gifts. We mentioned it earlier and we went into a bit into detail. So each of us was uniquely designed by God with talents, gifts, skills, and abilities. The way we are wired is not an accident. Not one of us on this earth came by accident. Remember, we said God is extremely organized. So He doesn't do things just for the sake of it. Anything that happens around you that's an act of nature, there's a reason for it. You say God did not give you abilities for selfish purposes. So your abilities, your gifts, your talents, they're not there for you to use it just for yourself and your family. And this is a big one. I want everyone out here to believe, you know, that's listening, to take on. There is something in you that's unique. There is something in you that nobody else has the way you have it. They were given to benefit others just as other people were given abilities to benefit you too. So all of us sitting back here today, gaining things from other people, example, Facebook, yes, we are live on Facebook. YouTube, yes, we download information there. eBay, we go there, we buy things. Amazon, same thing. Google, we type in something, we get answers. You know, various websites, including me sitting down here chatting with you. These are all gifts that God gave people and they used it, and that's why we are benefiting from it. So what gift do you have that I too can benefit from you? What gift do you have that other people around you can benefit from you? So that's a big message, because anytime you share your gift, you're glorifying God. It's a piece of God in you that's bringing that out. And that's why for me personally, I never can rest until I've shared whatever it is with the world. You remember we talked about experience as well, where I was talking about it. You know, what I find, especially us, now I'm going to come down a bit, black people. What happens to us is when things happen, we try to hide it. We look for the, you know, it's like, I don't know, I'll call it like a carpet. We take it, we put it underneath and we stand on it and let nobody ever know that such a thing has ever happened to you. But people learn. We learn from each other. So a mistake you have experienced, you could share it. And then the other person say, oh yeah, I remember when that person went through. And that's why people write books. Because it's their experience they're writing in the books. Which I know I owe the world loads of books. Because trust me, I know I have that duty to mankind. To contribute my experiences in books to the world. Books I read, and it says, what you should rather be asking yourself is, what do I owe the world? What do I know that I can give to the world that's different? That's what I want you to take on today. What do you have? What are those experiences you've been through? Because when, you know, like we talked about, I said I was having marital problems. And I know so many people who would rather go and hide and say it's never happened to them. And they want to paint this glossy picture out there in the world and look at how amazing my life is. And they go back home and they cry their eyes out. Sharing. They say a problem shared is a problem halved. So the minute you talk it out and share with another person, don't give a flying hoot if this person is going to gossip with you about you and tell the rest of your friends. I don't care. You know what? I actually come on camera and I talk about my problem. Because when I do that, I have said it. So I am in control. I am the one in that power position. It's not to somebody. And then when I hear it from somebody else, I'm like, oh, but I told only you. How come you now went and told other people? So that's what happens. But if you actually own up to what you're sharing and say, listen guys, this is what has happened to me and this is how I felt about it and I feel this way now, you have overcome that problem. You have overcome it. But the minute you keep it to yourself and you don't say to anyone, you haven't overcome it. That's when that problem eats you up. So take problems out and share it. That's what they call experiences. Because all my experiences of traveling the world, all my experiences of coming to England and setting up and having children, and all of those are experiences that will benefit people. My experiences of losing my job, my experiences of starting a new business, my experience, all these are the things I share. And that's why when students come here and they hear me talk, they go, wow, I did not just go to learn a skill, but I learned so much from this woman. I have so many testimonials that say that, and I feel good sharing my experiences with people. So when you keep these things to yourself, you're actually dishonoring God. You're not glorifying Him. Because what He said in chapter 5, life is a test. So all these things are meant for you to go through them. And when you've gone through them, you overcome them. Because you overcoming them means you can then tell other people to be strong as well in similar scenarios. So there's somebody I watch on YouTube. His name is Miles Monroe. He's died now. Somebody also introduced him to me. And his take was die empty. That's what he said. He said die empty. And what does that mean? The same gifts that God has wired into all of us, if we can bring it all out and give it to the world, by the time our 70, 80, or 100 years is done, we've cleared it all out of our system. And then there's nothing you're taking back home again to God. You're coming back because you've given all the gifts He gave you to the world. That was the big message. And I've read somewhere as well where they say the graveyard is the richest place in the world. And why is that? Because lots of people die with so much ideas in their head that they never wanted to share with anyone. And if you think this is bad, trust me, our Africa is the biggest place that does that. People will know things and they will never give a hint to anybody else. Oh, let me keep it to myself. You're not glorifying God. You're meant to share it. Because when you share it, you benefit other people with that knowledge, with that experience, with that talent, with that gift. And that's how it spreads out. Because as you're giving to people, you're getting back as well. And that's why the universe comes to your aid. He said, we bring glory to God by telling others about Him. So that's the other way we bring glory to God. So those are our five ways of bringing glory to God. And His purpose to be kept as a secret. So again, like I always say to people, God has been so kind to me. He's been so wonderful. Look at all the amazing things He's done for me. I remember one time I traveled to China. And it was such an experience. When I went to this place, I had no clue what I was going to find. I joined a trade mission and I went. But I knew what I wanted to get out of the trade mission. And I got there. And it wasn't there. I was looking for hair. I was looking at, you know, various sources, where can I get them, how can I buy them in quantity. And they didn't have anything about hair in this trade mission, and I felt so lost. I felt I'd wasted my time, I felt I left town, I felt I spent all this money and nothing was going to come out of it. And just as I was giving up and about to walk back to go and get a cab to go to my hotel, a voice just said to me, look up there. Because I saw people walking towards a direction. And so I looked, and lo and behold, there was this huge show going on about hair and beauty. I had no clue about this event. I came for this big trade mission that was in this huge hall that I had gone up and down till 5 p.m. in the evening. My feet were hurting. And I thought, okay, maybe because I didn't go to the right floor, maybe because, so I was all over the place. By the time I came, I was worn out and tired and ready to give up. And the calm voice just said to me, follow these people, look up. And I saw it, hair and beauty. It was the first day. This was like about 5 p.m. I could not wait to go and buy the ticket to go in. This is 5 p.m. The thing will be closing soon, but I said, I'm going in. And I bought the ticket and I went in. And I was like a child in a candy shop. and I saw all the things I wanted. Now, instances like that, there is no other answer to it than God just coming to me and telling me what to do. And I have so many instances like that in my life. So what he's saying is, do not hide when God has done things for you from other people. Tell them. You glorify God by sharing his love to other people, his messages. Because when you keep it to yourself, then people who don't believe will say, yeah, yeah, there's no God. But if you tell people the amazing things, you hear people say miracles and wonders and all of that. God has done something amazing for you. You share it with other people. I have healthy children, four healthy children doing amazingly well in their own little ways. I praise God for it. I am in good health. I mean, since I had my last child, I haven't seen a doctor for any reason. I thank God for it. And I will share that with everybody. So whatever God has done for you, share it. Be proud of God. Tell him you're happy for all the wonderful things he's done for you. Because when you do that, the universe appreciates you as well. And so we then go further. He says, what will you live for? Says, living your life for the glory of God will require change of your priorities, your schedules, your relationships, and everything else. It will mean choosing a difficult path instead of an easy one in some instances. He said Jesus also struggled with this too. Knowing he was about to be crucified, he cried, my soul has become troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose, I came to this hour. Father, glorify thy name. So the purpose of Jesus coming was to die at that hour for us. And when he was being taken that hour, even he struggled and said, but I came for this hour to glorify your name. So what he's saying to us is, yes, as we begin to understand our spiritual reason for being here, as we begin to understand why we're here, that the purpose is not just for us. It's not just for us to make money and live large and buy houses and buy hair extensions and makeup and look good all the time. There's a bigger reason. And the purpose is to glorify God. And so, Jesus stood on the road, on this road. So would he fulfill his purpose and bring glory to God, or would he shrink back and live a comfortable, self-centered life? So that was Jesus at that point. He's asking himself, should I carry on with this mission, which is the main reason I came, or should I just relax back and be comfortable? And I say that to us several times as well. It's like when I travel home and to Nigeria and it's really tough. I meet all these stressful situations and things are not like you would say we have it here in the West. And you get people say to me, but are you okay? Are you okay? You know, you're not used to that. I said, no, I'm used to it. I'm used to it. Just because I've been here for X number of years. Before I came here, I went through all that. And so, somewhere at the back of my mind, I just believe, you know, God already prepared me for all of this. So I'm ready to take it on. And so I take it on. So whatever sacrifices you have to make in order to glorify God, because he has a bigger mission for you. So he's put you here with all these gifts and skills and talents to share with the rest of the world. And that's why you see me like, I know that a bigger mission for me is not just here. I know I have a bigger mission out there to go and help as many people that need the knowledge that I've achieved, the experiences that I've been through, the skills that I have. I know I have a bigger mission to share that. And that's why I'm starting here, sharing it with you first, because we're on this journey together. So he says we face the same choices, just like Jesus went through. Will you live for your own goals, your own comfort and your pleasure, or will you live the rest of your life for God's glory? So that's the message here. The Bible says, anyone who holds on to life as it is destroys that life. I know that passage in the Bible. He says, anyone that wants to live will lose it. So if you want to, you just think that life is all about living and being happy, he says you'll lose it. I think he also, there was a parable or a passage in the Bible about this rich man who had everything, and he told himself, my soul, relax and eat and marry and have so much fun. Look at all the wealth I have and everything. And that very night, God says, your soul, I demand of you. And all that living large and merry and owning the mansions and everything he had, he never lived to enjoy it. So that's what it is. It's about anyone who's on, who holds on to life as safe as it is right now, destroys that life. But if you let it go, you gain it forever. So if you're here hoping to just focus on your dreams and your ideas of what life should be and everything that makes who you are, it will just lead to nothing. But if you focus on God's glory and aim to do the reason he sent you here, it will be a better journey for you, because it will be more meaningful. That's the only physical way I can explain it, because now we're going past physical into spiritual. Because if people who have gained so much wealth still struggle to find peace of mind, what other reason can we give? Look around you. Just because they have money doesn't make them happy. And so those of us who don't have money, we think, oh yeah, until I have money, I'm not gonna be happy. But that peace of mind is priceless. You cannot buy it with money. And so that's where it is. So who are you going to live for, yourself or for God? God is inviting us to live for his glory by fulfilling the purpose he made us for. It is the only way to live. Everything else is just existing. So everything else we do, we just exist. We're actually not living for God. So Bible says, to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. So for as long as you surrender to God and say, okay, Father, open my purpose for me, let me know what it is you sent me here for, you become his child, because then he's going to guide you. And so that's how that particular chapter ended. But let me just read the little bits that I have in the, this time is a yellow card. So he says, where in my daily routine can I become more aware of God's glory? And that was the question he gave, because normally he gives us a passage where the question comes in. So now you need to be asking yourself, where in my daily routine can I become more aware of God's glory, so that you know what you're doing? He said, the Bible says, God has given gifts to each of us. This explains the whole thing about the gifts that we talked about. From his great variety of spiritual gifts, manage them well so that God's generosity can flow through you. So that's a big message. You want God's generosity to flow through you. So like I'm sitting down here reading this book, happy to share with you. As I'm sitting down here sharing all the knowledge and skills that I have in a home training park, I'm sitting down here telling people to come and gain skills that will help them create money for themselves. They can take care of their family through that. I am allowing God's generosity in me flow through. He said, are you called to help others? Do it with all the strength and energy that God has supplied you. So every energy you have, every strength in you that God has given you, use it to support others. Then God will be given glory. So once you do that, you have given God glory, because the gifts he gave to you, you did not hold them back selfishly. So the Bible says, you are worthy, O Lord our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created everything. So once you give glory to God by sharing everything he gave to you, you have given him glory, and God is worthy of that glory. Sin and come short of the glory of God. So once we start doing these things, we start, it says, atoning for your sin. You start reflecting and giving back slowly to God. Because by us sinning, we just went short. We didn't know what it is that God wants from us. This book is slowly trying to open our eyes again to see the things that we didn't see. Because we end up in this selfish mode where everything is about ourselves. I haven't got money, I haven't got food, I haven't got kids, I haven't got husband, I haven't got a house, I haven't got education. And so we just go on and on about ourselves. But we don't know that we have it all, and it's for us to give it out. He said, living for God's glory is our greatest purpose and mission. And God says, they are my own people, and I created them to bring me glory. So how amazing is this? Again, as usual, we always want you to send us messages, but we don't see any messages, so we're quite happy to carry on if we don't hear anything from anyone. But seriously, I want you to take on this little homework. Everything we've done up to this point, has anything happened in your life? Have you felt any little kick or a little tinge? Because I've been feeling it. I've been feeling it in the sense of I'm a lot lighter, I'm a lot more forgiven. Like if something happens that I would probably have taken time to think about, I said, no, why should I do that? I am here to do God's work, and my mission here needs to be fulfilled. So that's just nothing. 70 years, 80 years, 100 years, hey, what's the point holding grudges against anyone? What's the point getting angry? What's the point creating enmity? Being envious, being, what's the other one? Being jealous. Because you are you. You have been wired specially by God for unique things. So you need to just tap into yourself and work with God to know what this uniqueness of yours is. So I'm going to leave us here today, and tomorrow we carry on to chapter 8. But may God continue to bless you abundantly and eternally. Thank you so much, and I see you tomorrow.